stillness together. We were in relationship to one another. That's what I'm. That's what I'll talk about tonight. But I do want to acknowledge. Does anyone know what week of Ongo we're in? We're getting close to being. We're getting close to being halfway.
Midterms.
What's that?
Midterms.
Yeah, we're getting close
midterms.
To being halfway. So I hope everybody's enjoying this time of either slightly or significantly intensified practice. So our theme for Ongo is three parts: non-knowing self, non-knowing others, and non-knowing world. And we talked about non-knowing self a few weeks ago. Last time Geoff Sensei spoke, he talked about non-knowing others, but he wanted me to talk about it again tonight. So I will. That's what this will be about. And hopefully I'll add a different perspective or something additional to our view of this. And as I always like to say, don't believe anything I say. Do your own investigation. These are just my opinions and perspectives. Let them go as soon as you hear them. What I wrote down was just take them with a fistful of salt. The Lakota have an expression, Matakiwe Oyasin, and it translates as all are related. All are related. And they're serious about it. I was talking to a Lakota friend of mine just today, coincidentally. And when I talk to Wendell, I never really know who's in his family. Blood family. They have a term, Toshpai, that is sort of family plus. But I think it's beautiful. And it could be his kids, it could be his grandkids, it could be a friend, it could be somebody who's a ghost. All are related. Relations, relationships. Joko Beck said, every moment of our life is relationship. There's nothing except relationship. I find that a bit of a challenging thing to hear. Because there are times where I very much want to be very much think that I am alone. You can't see me, I have my eyes closed. Like a little kid, hiding from the world. Every moment of our life is relationship. There's nothing except relationship. So we have all kinds of these relationships. Parents, kids, siblings, colleagues, friends, lovers, partners, teachers, sangha, strangers, the cashier at Lucky Market in North Pole. Those bad guys, us good guys, ancestors, future generations, ghosts, animals, bugs, birds, plants, rocks, water, air, and fire. All are related. My ideas and my fears, my longings and my regrets, my guilt and my pride, my house needing cleaning, shopping to be done, bills to pay. We're in relationship with all of these all the time. And we're called to take care of our relationships with all of these. cling. Maybe we cling to romantic love, to good times that we're having with other people, to temporary peacefulness, and to fantasies about how it is, who I am and who he or she is. Or we push away stuff. We try to avoid or deny conflict in our relationships. Past losses and hurts, old grudges, unresolved issues, wounds, defenses. Not knowing is how we practice with all of this. What really does that mean? Sensei suggested, I think the last time he spoke, that what that means is to abide in my own center and my own equanimity. Think about yourself, all your stories and histories and preferences, subtle feelings, and the things that make you feel sad or joyous or angry or ecstatic. Who else knows these things about you? I was thinking about this the other night, and I feel like I'm pretty, I hope I'm transparent. I have a belief system that I'm pretty transparent. It might be nonsense, I don't know. But in my case, and in some ways, I feel I shout all that stuff at the world all the time. Whether it's a Facebook post or some essay that I write or bending somebody's ear until they want to run away. I really want people to know me. But I'm fairly certain no one really does. In that way, I feel utterly alone. So what are my chances of knowing someone else in relationship to them? Perhaps no. Do we have to understand others to relate to them? I asked myself that the other day. Do we have to categorize or rank or judge where they fit in my relationship, mandala or hierarchy or landscape? Do all our relations need to look peaceful or be resolved or feel good? I think some of these questions answer themselves. All of my relations are not peaceful. They're not all resolved and they don't all feel good. And how do, and the big one, how do we practice non-knowing others in the midst of rising racism and militant wokeness and hate speech and everyone being backed into their corners? A few people, I think, heard this a number of years ago since I made a statement that I found extraordinary. I saved it. Stillness answers every question. Being still, I can hear others and I can feel them. That helps me be in relationship with them. It's a way of non-knowing others. Being still, I can hear myself. And perhaps, if I'm diligent, I can pause long enough to feel before I speak. When we take care of all of our relations by non-knowing, what does that look like? Does it include fighting? War? Is it always gentle and happy? Do we sometimes need to bail out and leave a relationship? And sometimes is that relationship over forever? And if so, are we still in a relationship? Here's a strategy. Do I succeed by successfully choosing, quote unquote, just the right people with whom I can be happy? I think this some version of this quote goes back to Freud. Joni Mitchell used it as well, and a number of other people. I'm not really sure who to attribute it to. But the one I like is Tom Waits. If I exercise my devils well, my angels may leave too. All are related. I like this. It doesn't mean that I seek out difficult or corrupt people, or that I hang out in biker bars or some watering hole in Washington, D.C. at the Watergate Hotel, but rather that I receive everyone when they come. When I was much, much younger, I felt like to sort of test my faith, I needed to put myself into dangerous situations to see if I can deal with it. Foolish, kind of silly thing to do. All I really needed to do is to receive everyone when they come. Anybody who read the newsletter yesterday, I poached this from my talk and put it in the newsletter because I like it. I like the story so very much. David Chadwick wrote a great history of Shunryu Suzuki Roshi and San Francisco Zen Center. And if you haven't read it, it's seminal. It's really, really good. And it's very readable. It's called Crooked Cucumber, which is a nickname for Suzuki Roshi. And the San Francisco Zen Center, like the Zen Center of LA, began as part of the Soto Zen mission in the city. It was all Japanese people. And Suzuki Roshi, as did Maizumi Roshi, came from Japan to assist with the local Japanese-American sangha. And then hippies came, and the rest is history. And they were on Bush Street in San Francisco, and San Francisco Zen Center got organized, and they, you know, had bigger plans. And in 1970, they bought a building on Page Street. And at the time, in 1970, the building on Page Street, the neighborhood was really dangerous. You know, it was not like now. Poor people, crime. It was a tough place. And this is my favorite story from that book. And I think, I could be wrong. I think this speaks right to this topic of relationship and non-knowing others. So this is a quote from Chadwick. The sangha quickly learned that the doors to the building had to be locked. Neighborhood children figured out right away that the Zennies were suckers. They would roam the building at will. Things were stolen. And one day, three tough young black teenagers came in the open door, and they were having fun being sassy to a few students who were trying to be good, discriminating liberals. Suzuki Roshi approached in his robes, carrying his short teaching stick. A teaching stick's only about this long, I think. It's not a kisaki. It's harmless. And they said to him, "Hey, the man in the robes! You know karate? Do you fight?" teenagers demanded of him. Suzuki's eyes lit up and he walked right up to them, this short little Japanese guy, unthreatening yet full of spunk. "What's the stick for?" the biggest kid said. "To hit you with." And he smacked him on the shoulder. Then he escorted them to the front door while they laughed and sparred with him. I think, and that's the end of the Chadwick part. I think Suzuki Roshi was manifesting non-knowing and deep wisdom when he did this, if not utter extraordinary fearlessness. Fearlessness in relationship. I think fearlessness is a method of expression of non-knowing. I think it might be one of the most important gifts we can give another person in relation. In relationship. If I meet somebody and I'm fearful, then I have some idea, I have a knowing idea, that something bad might happen. I have a preconceived idea of who this person is and what to expect that they might do. And perhaps that's a good idea. Perhaps that's a good thing to do. Perhaps I do need to defend myself. Maybe I know who they can be and I choose a defensive posture. But what if I don't do that? Roshi surely knew these kids would easily hurt him, or could, and may have some pattern of doing so in the neighborhood. Was he just being foolish, being so unguarded and provocative? He was fearlessness, and his fearlessness diffused this situation. He was non-knowing. I mentioned Joko Beck earlier. She's one of my favorite teachers, and if you haven't picked it up or don't have it or haven't read it, her book, Everyday Zen, is a giant piece of Zen teaching. And it's somewhat surprising. It's not what you would expect. And she talked a lot about relationships. She has a chapter titled, Relationships Don't Work. So she kind of zings you before you even start the chapter. And she said, well, what does work then? The only thing that works, if we really practice, is a desire not to have something for myself, but to support all life, including individual relationships. Now you may say, well, that sounds nice, I'll do that. But nobody really wants to do that. We don't want to support others. To truly support somebody means that you give them everything and expect nothing. You might give them your time, your work, your money, anything. If you need it, I'll give it to you. Love expects nothing. Instead of that, we have these games like, I'm going to communicate so our relationship will be better. Which really means, I'm going to communicate so you'll see what I want. She goes on, the underlying expectation we bring to those games ensures that relationships won't work. If we really see that, then a few of us will begin to understand the next step of seeing another way of being. So relationships, non-knowing others. I see this as our first and most enduring practice. After all, every day we say, numberless creations I vow to receive. It's the first of the Bodhisattva vows. That's about relationship. And that can't be done without non-knowing. This is our vow, isn't it? Numberless creations seems to sound like no one and no thing is excluded or left out. Angels and demons, friends and foes, us and them. And how do we receive them? Not knowing. Stillness. My friend Roshi Michelle Ingu Dobbs, his clown name is No Can Do, works with young poor kids in jail in the system in New York State, and very, very gently and lightly teaching them mindfulness. And he realized he couldn't walk in with the three tenets and share that with them in those words. Because it's all they're a little bit inscrutable, so he changed them to empty mind, open heart, kindly acting, and his kids get it. And if you'll indulge me on this last bit, we'll wrap up. Bernie talked about this all the time, including everybody in the meal at the table. He wanted everyone at the table. No one left out. He had Krishna Das put this little section of the Gate of Sweet Nectar to music. Some of you know this. I don't start crying. And I'm no singer. God knows this. Join me if you like. Calling out to hungry hearts everywhere through endless time. You who wander, you who thirst, I offer you this Bodhi mind. Calling out to hungry spirits everywhere through endless time. Calling out to hungry hearts, all the lost and the left behind. Gather around and share this meal, your joy and your sorrow, I make them